real pleasure for me to see you here. I feel a little bit proud. And first session will start now with 10 minutes delay, which is not much in Brazilian sense. And Professor Hans Browning will start with the first session from, he's from Technical University of Delft in the Netherlands. He'll talk about comparison of capillary pressure and relative permeability obtained with network models and percolation theory. So, please.
Can everybody hear me? It's a real pleasure to be here. And I noticed that the first time I stayed in Rio de Janeiro was when Bush was half elected in Florida. And then I was watching the television, of course. And the question to us the pure statisticians was that it was possible that Bush got all of the votes, and this poor statistician, he said, "I am. That can be, but it is really unlikely." And the lawyer said, "I only want one answer: yes or no." So, yeah, to say that, and sometimes we are confronted with that. But I have a real pleasure of being here. Long collaboration with Dan Marsersin, Alexei, and well. There are many others, which Amaury, we recent. I cannot, let me just not finish it like that because I forget somebody. And it's always a pleasure to be here. The talk I'm giving here is that we were always doing percolation theory, and that I thought that was a little bit boring to do that again. So I started to compare it to network models, but I realized a little bit, and also my co-author, that it is a little bit, in a sense, challenging what I'm going to say. So it is more that I want you to share some ideas and thought with me than that I'm really going to say that this is the definite truth of it. So, let me see. Yeah. Of course, I do not need to get you awake, but Mark Twain and Benjamin Disraeli, we do not know who was really responsible for the quote. That is a little bit unclear, but I've been paraphrasing what they said. There are lies, there are damned lies, and then the quote is, of course, there are statistics. And an anonymous petroleum engineer said that, I think it was Arnold de Vries, actually, and unfortunately he died, so I'm definitely going to attribute it to him, and relative permeabilities. Yeah. So I'm going to talk about relative permeabilities, and that is controversial, that's clear. So Mark Twain was a writer in the 19th century, and Benjamin Disraeli was a prime minister. And Queen Victoria was also happy that she bought all the shares of the Suez Canal, if you remember that. Yeah. Okay, relative permeabilities, they are, a lot of them are semi-empirical. They are related to some idea of what we think about. Basically, we say that the permeability of a single phase will always be hampered by the presence of the other phase. So that means that the relative permeability is a little bit lower than one, and it is a correction factor for the permeability. We can do that also. We can derive these relative permeabilities with percolation theory, and you can also do it with network models. And And I think that what I want to controversially discuss with you is that the current network models or percolation do not cover or are swamping completely what's called representative elementary volume. So, in laboratory setups, that is, yeah? Extension of percolation theory to an arbitrary set of pore throats, that was Hamid Reza's contribution. I think it is possible. And that means that why wouldn't you do percolation theory instead of network models? That's what is argued. And I did this at the last moment. And two E's with W is a Dutch word, but that is not. It's meant to be water wet. And the whole idea about low salinity surfactant is that the idea is that water wet is better, and I think that is not necessarily true. Actually, the guys who did that originally, Morrow, also knows that. But there is a whole load of people who think that we like water wet. Okay, so the definition of relative permeability, that's in terms of, is that it is related to the total flow rate, the viscosity, the absolute permeability, the surface area, and a pressure gradient, and it is of either the wetting phase or the non-wetting phase. I'm a petroleum engineer, so the wetting phase is water, and the non-wetting phase is oil. Yeah. So, and that's our empirical models. And the typical shapes, if you have come across it, are in the top right corner. You see typically these things as a function of the water saturation. And if it is water wet, that is the interesting thing, then it behaves like this. And if it is oil wet, it behaves slightly different. Yeah. So I didn't know whether Lien van Genuchten would be here, so I would like to mention him. There's a famous Dutch guy, Lien van Genuchten, who decided that he liked to be in the Dutch winter, he liked to be in Brazil. And consequently, he has a Brazilian wife, and of course, but he is very famous of having defined these relative permeability empirical relations. And what's more, he's a very nice and pleasant person. So whenever you have a student and you feel a little bit embarrassed because the student is not really motivated, you ask Lien van Genuchten to talk to him for 10 minutes, and then he will be enthusiastic for the rest of his life. Yeah. So that is the issue is that there is a dependence on the initial water saturation. As we see, if the initial water saturation is high, then the if it is high, then it is this tiny little bit here at 0.3, and you see that the residual oil saturation, which is this part here, is really high, and that the endpoint permeability is really low. Yeah, that's typically behavior of water wet reservoirs, and let me see whether. So water wet media have a really high residual oil saturation and low endpoint permeabilities. And every petroleum engineer knows that that is very nice because the mobility ratio means that it is favorable if it's water wet. And all people who want to recover all the oil are really not so happy because the amount of oil which is stuck in the reservoir is really high. Yeah, that's so. Well, I do not know how much I have to dwell on this, but this is a wetting index. A wetting index is usually defined by using a capillary pressure, and you look at these two areas, you take the logarithm of that, and that is a kind of wetting index which is practically used. There are these guys, Lomland, that are recent people from Norway, a number of other people who have been making empirical relations with relative permeabilities which are a little bit more sophisticated. And then what we see here, I plotted all these data, and I see that, again, this story is that the residual oil saturation is really high. That is this residual oil saturation, if things become really water wet, which is here, if the water index gets high. If the water, if the wetting index gets less, then the residual oil saturation gets lower, and then a looks like this. And you can also, the irreducible water saturation, you can relate it to this USBM index, which is here. And then actually, we have a poster, if you're all interested in it, tomorrow you can see it. And you can be happy to use these equations just to see, okay, what's happening when tanks become water wet and oil wet, how do I deal with relative permeabilities? There was actually years ago I met him, Mohamed Sahimi. He's a really funny character, and he is, I know that Bill Rossen was the head of our department. He was studying with him, and the incredible amount of output which he has, and a few books, and one of his books is this Applications of Percolation Theory, and whether he proposed to use, I think he was at the heart of it. Heiba and Davis were also there to say, okay, we can use percolation models to predict relative permeabilities. So what is the, elements of percolation theory? It seeks to describe by these beautiful sentences, by statistical means, the morphology and transport through randomly disordered media. And if this sounds all very abstract to you, I will be more concrete with it. The theory is, of course, is valid for network models that consist of branches and bonds, bonds and nodes, which are sites of junctions. All properties of pore throats are assigned to bonds. Nodes are zero-dimensional feature. That's a simplification which I will be using in my case, but it's not necessary. Percolation threshold, that are typical notions which happen in percolation theory. It's percolation threshold is one of them. Allowed pores is another one of them. Accessible pores is another one. And occupied pores, you will understand in a moment what it is. And the theory of percolation theory was typically developed in the 20th century when people were starting with their computers and do some computations and see how it went. And I think if you find such a computer now on the street, the most sophisticated one which we used at the Technical University of Delft for everybody, you will not even stop. We all in the Netherlands ride bicycles. You will not even stop your bicycle to get it. Yeah, that is. But anyway, they did a lot of work with that, yeah? So, well, the general idea is that I'm a pyromaniac, and a pyromaniac has one aim in his life, and that is to ignite a wood here on the bottom. He ignites the wood, and then what he likes is that the wood is consisting of gardens, and all the gardens, if they have a tree, they have number one assigned to them, and if no tree, then they have assigned a number zero to them. And the game which I play is that the a tree can ignite another tree north, west, east, or south of it. Yeah, and then if I see how this connection goes, I see that if I am saying that every number which is bigger than 0.5 is assigned a one, and every number below 0.5 is assigned a zero, then I will be a hopeless failure as a pyromaniac, because my wood fire will get through until it cannot get any further. Yeah, so that's not my idea of it. Yeah, my idea is rather to have a situation like this, where you have more than if the number is larger than 0.4, I put a 1 to it, and then you can see that you are really, as a pyromaniac, you are really successful, because you ignite it here, and you will get in the end, and will get to the other side of the wood. Yeah, so that is the. And so there are a few words, maybe I think they are in the next slide, yeah. So I have a few words, which is that I have what's called accessible pores, and accessible pores, which are pores that have a tree. In our case, it will pores which have are having a certain condition of capillary number, so that oil can be pushed in them. Yeah, I think you have as experience that you are having a glass of lemonade and a little straw, and you have to blow in it a little bit to get water out of that, yeah? So that's what's happening here. So one means that my pore is big enough so that I can achieve that. And then this whole green area is called an accessible fraction. And if pores here, we have isolated pores, which indeed are large enough to, in principle, to contain some fluid, but they are allowed, as it is called, but they are not part of the accessible fraction. And it depends on the situation, whether such a pore, which is isolated but is allowed, whether it happens to contain some oil or not. Yeah. So you know everything already, as I see. You get bored with it. Okay. So I was first confronted with percolation theory when I was when Pavel Bedrikovetsky, he was sitting opposite to me in Delft for half a year, and he had this idea: is why are we? That is well, one of, as far as I'm concerned, Pavel's hallmarks. He is always doing this, makes a very simple formula out of something, and he can do something with it. So he makes the extreme, because you cannot believe how complicated these formulae are when you look at them in literature. So he suggested something really simple for the accessible fraction. And if I plot that, then the accessible fraction is on the vertical axis here, the allowed fraction is here, and you see this typical behavior that here you have a percolation threshold. That means if you are below the percolation threshold, nothing can get through. And if you are above the percolation threshold, it really starts to take off really fast. Yeah. So, and this has an infinite slope, et cetera, et cetera. And he figured this all out by these old-fashioned computers of the 20th century. Yeah. So the whole idea boils down to the fact that I have a pore distribution like I have here. And that means that all pores which are large enough, you can force, like blowing it, you can force some oil in them, and then a fraction of those pores is accessible. These pores are all allowed, a fraction is accessible, and then you can say, okay, I calculate the capillary pressure, I delineate the accessible region and calculate the pore volume, I divide the pore volume by the total volume to get the oil saturation. The corner of the pores, I take triangular pores. This was one of these ideas of Martin Blunt to take the to get away from cylindrical pores. So he so the corner of the pores are filled with water, and then we use the effective minimum approximation. An effective minimum approximation says that you have a distribution of pore sizes, and then what you do is you take on this point, you say, okay, now here I take one of those, I take here, and I do it in an average of permeabilities, and then I want that the distribution of, this is the distribution of pores of of conductance P, and I want that this formula is equal to zero, which is actually the contribution of, if I have something in a which is equal medium and I have something which deviates, I get this point, and I say if I have had all the various possibilities of conductances, the net effect should be zero. And this formula I happens to be a few times in my life, I was so happy because it contains the percolation threshold. It is really beautiful. It is simple and beautiful at the same time, yeah? So Hamid Reza Salimis, that's my co-author. He has a slightly different. He has the approach that he said, okay, but we can do it for one type of pore. We can also do it for all kinds of distributions. We can add them. I'm sorry about that. Add them together, and then in the end, that means that any type of reservoir can be squeezed into the idea of percolation theory. So this is the way to do that. This formula looks, if you remember, this is the formula for one distribution, but you can use many distributions and you can generalize that. And that means that, that gives gives a kind of possibility of generalization. And you can have all kinds of poor, we confined our interest to poor cylindrical pores, which are all kinds of shapes in the corners. Of course, it is water wet. In the corners, there is water. So this is it. And I think that this we took this Wahid Jokar, which one of the students of Majid Hasanizade. For those of you who find it difficult to remember his name in Iranian, Zadeh, I do not speak Iranian at all. Zadeh means son of. So in the Netherlands, people are called Jansen, and means son of Jan. And I'm sure that you have all these names. And he's the son of Hassan. And but you can have he did this. You can have all kinds of shapes, and then you can do a calculation, which is if it is just a cylindrical pore, it's really easy. You can do it with Excel. You can immediately find out how much flows through all kinds of two-dimensional structures. It is very simple. So typically the capillary pressure, we did equilateral triangles. There are two possibilities, as I said. It's whether a pore is occupied or not occupied. When it is allowed, it can be that the oil phase did not reach it, and it's not occupied, or when the oil phase in the past did reach it, then it is occupied. You can have two situations, and one situation is like this situation here, the green one, that is primary drainage. But if you calculate the occupied pores, then you have secondary drainage. You can easily find capillary pressure. As a matter of fact, I cannot show everything, but we compared with Wahid, and there is no discussion possible on the capillary pressure, whether you do it with percolation theory or with network modeling. It doesn't really matter. You always seem to get roughly the same result. This is relative permeability. Relative permeability, again, we have the same situation. So this is a relative oil permeability or non-wetting phase permeability. And what we see, which is really interesting, is that at the end, for a saturation almost equal to one, so you need a tiny little bit of oil, it winds itself through the porous medium, and then it already starts to flow. And poor petroleum engineers get really frustrated with that, because they get gas involvement in their reservoirs when they lower the pressure. And what they like, of course, is that the gas stays in the reservoir. No, it doesn't stay in the reservoir. A tiny little bit of gas will find its way through the pores. And then that means that already at a very small oil saturation, the whole thing starts to flow. And of course, if it is gas, the viscosity is low. So this is really one of the, which I find one of the nice achievements of percolation theory, is that it is able to model this effect. Yeah. And then there is another thing, is that according to us, the relative permeability to water is never really zero. It always does something. So that is also coming out of the percolation model. So the percolation models, in a sense, they give some qualitative features of relative permeability, which Brooks, Corey, etc., cannot do. Yeah. And for a long time, of course, in the Netherlands, we have this beer company, which is Heineken, and you drink beer. And Heineken had a long time an advertisement that Heineken beer could reach parts of the body other fluids cannot reach. Yeah? So that is also, here is the case that water will get everywhere, and here oil will also get everywhere. So percolation modeling is doing that. Yes. Now we have... do we have still time? 10 minutes. Okay. So now we have network models. And network models is that you are looking at your core, and then you are putting in bonds and sites all over the place, so that you get a kind of structure like this, and then you are calculating with brute force. You are calculating what's going on. Yeah. So, I took this from the thesis of Wahid. Jokar, actually, we are still struggling with discussing what is going to be, and but we like that Wahid and Hamid Reza and are combining this paper, yeah. And this is the way it goes. You have that the total flow at a null point is equal to zero. What's coming in is coming out, which is really mad. Then you have a kind of Darcy's law here. This is related to the pressure difference. Oh, you want to take gravity, please go ahead. It only is technically complicated, but it's the same story. Of course, the sum of the water and the non-wetting phase saturation is one. Then he says, okay, you have a capillary pressure here, and my this permeability depends on the capillary pressure. That's the way he does it, and there is some, I still have to, some argument with Wahid and whether we are completely finished with this. You have something which is called the Kopelman algorithm, so much of the scientific achievements of 20th century people, they were, so you come to a pub and then you see a guy sitting in the corner and he's almost to the lowest level of social standard you can ever imagine, and then it turns out to be a Kopelman. I'm not saying that that is true, but these guys really gave a contribution to the society of major scientific importance. But they are never paid for it because they happen to be at the university and everybody was so happy that they did that for them, yeah? But he had this idea of if these are pores which are allowed, then you give them numbers and then you say, okay, if these numbers are connected to each other, you give them the same number, and then you find out what are the numbers which are connected to each other and not, and so here it is 1, 2, 7, and he found this algorithm to do that. Yeah? And so now I want to talk about structure of nodes and bonds near the percolation threshold. This is a picture which was made. I'm sorry that I do not know that anymore, but it is a brilliant picture. There are here some of these loose ends here. Well, the whole system is flooded with loose ends. So if I would draw the loose ends, you would not see anything in between anymore. And then here there are some connections to parts which are here, and this is a typical structure if you are near the percolation threshold. So I thought, okay, let's do that for our case. Let's take something ridiculous. Let's take 109 pores in a kind of cubic arrangement, and let's see how this accessible fraction and allowed fraction are behaving. And we would like that they are behaving like this, because then you have really this in this slope accessible versus allowed, which was originally drawn by Peter Kovetsky. But you see that the slope that here near the percolation threshold it is deviating. Yeah, so it is always now. No guy who's doing network model can ever dream of doing a 235 times 235 times 235 calculation. Usually they do 40 times 40 times 40, so they cannot even achieve that, and you see that they are not yet in the range that they are near. So if you are near the percolation threshold, this model where you can only do 40 times 40 times 14 is, I'm now saying something in a sense controversial, but 40 times 40 times 14 is something you cannot do. Here I have calculated with the network model our capillary pressure curve. I should have gone a little bit further, but okay, I was doing this. And Hamid Reza is not really happy with this. He thinks that this is a little bit suspicious that this happens at such a high water saturation. Yeah, so, okay. I said to him, well, I'm not able. I was trying to find out. I've been desperately finding out in the airplane. It always happens to me. I cannot find an error in my program, but I couldn't find errors in my program which contained errors all the same. So I have to accept that this is happening and we have to look further into it. which is more important here at the relative permeability to water. I decided to leave it in, but what we see, and I think is basically, well, you will not be very convinced perhaps, but true, is that you see that the relative permeability to for the relative oil permeability near the percolation threshold, which is here, is strongly dependent on the number of pores I take into account. Moreover, I was so proud with percolation theory that I already got some flow at almost zero oil saturation, and that doesn't happen as well. So I think that, well, percolation theory can tell us something about what we should do or not do with network model. So now I come to the conclusion. But this happened years ago. I was really Mohamed Sahimi did this already, and they did it in the 70s with Davis and Haiba. But I was really, kind of flabbergasted that percolation theory can be used to derive this constitutive relation. So Hamid Reza had this idea that we can use any combination of pore shapes, and thus it can help us to interpret constitutive relation from pore network models. The capillary pressure increases as the water saturation decreases until the water saturation almost approaches zero. That is something which people find strange. Everybody is used to use the initial water saturation, that is 0.2, and says, okay, that is that's the point at which water doesn't flow anymore. It doesn't flow for many geologic times. Well, Institut Français des Pétroles made a big deal out of this. They said that if you have any core in the lab, you always have water saturations which are always far too high. 1 minute? Okay. Primary relative permeabilities for non-wetting oil phase already deviate from zero. Well, I said that repeatedly, so we use the effective medium approximation. That's also not very interesting. Maybe in view of the time, I think I am going to show this. So finite size effects show up in even in network models of 235 times 235 times 235. Mind you, people who are doing network models are never using this type of sizes, yeah? The length of a representative elementary volume is 235 times psi, which is a characteristic length of a pore. And usually we are saying, okay, in a laboratory setup, as long as we have 50 grains, I used to be an experimentalist, if you have 50 grains, in a lateral dimension, we are all so happy. Well, you would not be happy if you try to predict a relative permeability near the percolation threshold. So that was it.